All right, friends, so welcome to your first session on physics for class 11th while you are in class 10th. Okay, so just wanted to know, first of all, how many of you were with the Centum earlier and you were the Centum student in class 10th? So can you just message me who all were the Centum students earlier? Okay, so Aiden, Aniket, Anirudh was for 2 years, Anish, okay, Surya, Momita, okay, good. So, anybody else? So we have a good number of students. Aiden was also from class 9th, okay. So you guys are pretty much aware of, the basic processes we follow in the Centum. But having said that, quite a few of you are new today. So we'll be covering up little bit of basics of how we will work with respect to physics, because I believe Akhil has given you a brief about the overall planner, about various exams and how you should take up all those things. So I'll be, my discussion will be related to physics per se. All right. So we can start now. See, before we even, start discussing upon the plan and other things, let me tell you the first thing that you will see, the most, the basic or the most important difference with respect to the class 10th physics and the class 11 physics is that now physics will be as big or as detailed a subject as the mathematics is in class 11th. Okay. In class 10th, you might have seen that physics was, physics came along with chemistry and biology inside a thin book, and you had a mathematics which was equivalent to physics, chemistry, and biology put together. Okay, now in class 11th onwards, I don't know how many of you are aware of, so that's why I'm telling you all of this. Going forward, you will have in class 11, you have two books of physics, okay, and that is equivalent to mathematics. You will have two books of chemistry, and that is more than mathematics, okay? And similarly, biology also has grown, fine? So first and foremost, you should understand this, that the things have changed a bit, okay? And you should be geared up for it, all right? So, I'm not scaring anybody here. I'm just letting you know that what is the basic difference with respect to 11th and 10th. Okay, in 10th, probably when you have exams of, let's say, science, all right, so you have one chapter of physics, one chapter of chemistry, one chapter of biology, and probably you will revise it n number of times before the exam comes. All right, now since syllabus is huge, so big, that you may not get time to revise it again and again before the exam comes, all right? So make sure that whatever you're doing, you should do it perfect the first time itself, okay? So today, let's say we discuss something, all right? Then today only, whatever doubts you have, do not hold on to yourself. Immediately you ask doubts and solve the assignment and just finish it off. Okay, maybe today or before the next physics class, you should be done with it. All right. So I think I have not introduced myself. I directly started talking about, the physics itself. So I'll just briefly introduce myself and then I will continue. Okay. I'm sure has anyone seen me in your school campus, or did I teach any one of you when you were in 9th and 10th? Oh, Surya is saying yes. Okay. Yeah, I remember now. I remember now. Correct, correct. I met a couple of you. All right. So, see, I am associated with Centum Academy for since the start, okay? And I take care of physics for grade 11th and 12th, all right? And I teach them, at various levels. So I'll just quickly go through my brief slide intro so that I should not miss on any details as such. So I have around 12 years of experience of teaching physics, okay? And in these 12 years, I have taught more than 5,000 students. They are cumulative numbers. And I have been training specifically for these exams, okay? And I'm sure you are also aiming for, one or more of these exams only. Okay. So is there any exam that you're aiming for and it is not listed here? Please let me know. Okay. And then, yeah, I have been fortunate enough to work with the student and generate these kind of ranks. Okay. And these ranks are all from NPS students only. We have just, let's say, 40 to 50 students who pass out from class 12th every year. So out of 50 kids, we have been able to generate great results. And I would like to see your name or your rank here also, maybe in a couple of years. Okay. So yes, I have done BTech from IIT Bombay in mechanical engineering. And I had a small experience in a company called Honeywell. I used to work in Honeywell in aeronautical division, which builds the aircraft. Then I thought that my interest lies more in teaching, so that's how it all started. Okay, so this is my brief introduction. I hope everybody now know me. So now coming back to the physics and with respect to kind of basic requirements you should have before you even start your class 11th journey. Okay. So I'll just go to this one. Okay, so many of you might be aiming for all of these exams, right? So can you just type in what are the exams you are aiming for? And it is perfectly fine that you can say that I am not clear. Okay, that is all fine. But if you're very clear that you're aiming for a particular exam, please type it out so that I have a better idea about the overall, this thing from you. Okay. Others? See, not sure is perfectly fine for time being, okay? But then maybe in a couple of months, you should be sure about it, okay? Because everybody else who is sure might have already started their journey towards it, okay? And yeah, I think many of you are interested in KVPI as well, okay? And KVPI, all right. Okay. So anyone preparing for NEET here? NEET? Medicals? Anyone? Oh, you've listed down all the exams. All the exams. You have not left anything. Okay. See, I'll just go through one by one. These exams. I'm sure Akhil might have discussed it already. I'll keep it very short and I don't, I'll probably will add up to it only. See, the first and foremost, all these exams which are related to, let's say, engineering. So you can see that there are how many exams are related to engineering per se? You have JEE Main, JEE Advanced. BITSAT, you can also say engineering. You can go to BSc, MSc as well. So you have three exams which are related to engineering. All right. You have Karnataka CET, which will take care of both medical and the engineering as well. But let me put it as engineering over here only. So all these four exams, okay, all these four exams, they are based out of same curriculum. Okay, so I'll just write it down. See, this is very important before we even start, because you should not think that since I'm preparing for BITSAT, I'll not pay attention to JEE Main, or I'm preparing for JEE Main, I'll not pay attention to Karnataka CET. Okay, so the exams of JEE or BITSAT, okay, the Karnataka CET, all these exams, they are based out of same curriculum. In fact, there are these talks going on that Karnataka CET might get merged with JEE Main. Okay, so probably by the time you write JEE, Karnataka CET will happen via JEE Main route. Okay, so they are based out of same curriculum. Then what is the difference? The difference is the number of questions in the exams. Okay, the difference is number of questions in the exam and probably little bit of difficulty level. Okay, number of questions and difficulty level is the difference. Fine. So right now, I would say that all of you, okay, all of you should aim for at least, if you are going through engineering route, okay, all of you should aim for at least JEE Main, if not JEE Advanced. Because, you know, you should not take the judgment of that you are not good based out of your class 10th performance or your class 9th performance. Okay, that is the worst thing you can do. I'll just give you my example. You know, I was studying in a place called Jabalpur. I'm not sure how many of you have heard of it. Jabalpur is a small town in Madhya Pradesh. Okay, so I have done my class 1 to class 11th. Yeah, MP. Class 1 to class 11th, mid of class 11th, I have done in Jabalpur. Okay, and there, in class 10th board, naturally, you know, your parents, you yourself or your friends will tell you that it is class 10th board. It is very, very important. Take it extremely seriously. Revise the syllabus 100 times and then go and write the exam. Okay, so I was also pretty serious, stressed up. So, you know, on the day of exam and all, I used to be very worked up and given the exam. All right. And during our times, I think now also it is changed, but before maybe 1 or 2 years back, there was a grade system. So now I got the result and my marks were 71 or 73% out of 100% marks. I got 73% marks. Okay. And I was very happy. The reason was I was ranked 3 in my class and the topper was around 82 or 83% marks. So in that small town, there was hardly any competition and I was like ranked 3 in 73% marks. I was extremely happy. So then my dad got transferred in Mumbai, Bombay. Okay. So there, you know, I got shock of my life. There, my dad, you know, make me go to that school. That school is Kendriya Vidyalaya School inside IIT Bombay itself. Okay, so there is a KV IIT, which is inside IIT Bombay. So I got admission there and I was so surprised. I was astonished to hear and see that none of the students in that batch, when I got admitted in class 11th, no one was less than 90% in science batch. And I got 73% marks and I got admitted with them. Okay, so naturally that, you know, little bit of inferiority complex came in. So I thought that I am not very good. Okay, so naturally it made me conscious and also made me work harder, made me a little bit, put extra effort so that I could at least compete with them, if not, do better than them. Okay. And slowly, as time progressed, a couple of months later on, I was, I seen that the topper in the class, I think she got around 96 or 97% in 10th. She was struggling in 11th. Okay. And I did not find it very difficult. Okay. And I have seen several students who have done well in class 10th. They were struggling. And several of the students who were unheard of, like there was one of my classmate, Ankur Rudra was his name. I remember most of the names. So he was not heard of till class 10th. And suddenly he is excelling in each and every exam. He was scoring so well. And later on in class 12th, I got 95% overall in the board exams. And I got through the JEE also. And I got a seat in IIT Bombay. And this guy who was Ankur, whose name is Ankur Rudra, he was ranked 125. And many of the students who did well in class 10th did not do well in any of the competitive exams. And vice versa also, there were students who were unheard of, suddenly they have done so well, okay? But having said that, I'm not saying that all the students who did well in 10th could not do well in 11th and 12th. Now, what I'm telling you is very important. What I'm telling you is that here is your chance, guys. Those who think that they could not get sufficient time, there was a lack of attention or whatever, distraction, whatever excuse you have, okay? And if you think that you could not do well because of all those excuses, here is your chance in class 11th onwards, okay? Wherein we will be discussing physics, chemistry, maths right from the scratch. Your chapter number one in physics is what is physics? Okay, so literally we are going through the scratch, all right? And why students struggle in class 11th and they do not struggle much in 10th is because you have to become little bit analytical in approach, okay? So, I'll be telling this again and again, but then you have to get this thing in your head that you should love problem solving, okay? You should not be a student who try to memorize everything. Never try to study class 11th and 12th like that. Okay. So that is the first most important thing. Fine. So that is about the engineering that I was discussing about. And then of course you have school to take care of. Okay. School requirement gets automatically filled. Automatically it will be done if you do any of the competitive level preparation, any of it, if you do, your school preparation is automatically done. All right. So don't take a lot of pressure with respect to the school requirement of 11th and 12th. Okay. And then of course, for the medical students, you have NEET. All right. NEET is something which was offline for years now, probably it will also become online. And then of course, physics of the NEET, probably the questions are little bit more different, okay? They are little bit more theoretically oriented than numerically oriented, okay? But having said that, everything is asked from the same curriculum, okay? I'm talking about with respect to physics. And of course, biology is one big this thing, fine? So, now the question comes, what should I refer with respect to physics, right? So yes, if I keep JEE Advanced separate, for JEE Main, BITSAT, Karnataka CET, Centum module, and our LMS is more than sufficient, okay? And we'll be giving you the assignments, which probably right now we'll not give you a lot of assignments because we have just started. But as the time progress, after every class, we'll be giving you assignments and it will be handpicked from various sources. Apart from that, there will be LMS wherein recorded lectures will be there. There will be assignments, online assignments will also be there. Okay, so all these resources are there. What I'm telling you is that don't be in a rush of buying books. Okay, that is something which doesn't help anyone. Okay, so do not try to accumulate books after books as the year progresses, and by the time exam comes, your rate of purchasing book goes up and you pile up huge set of books, which is useless. Okay, so make sure that you follow what is being told to you. You don't need to, let's say, purchase any book as such separately. And but then of course, if you are able to do the assignments in time, then you can come back to us and we'll let you know that, okay, fine, since you are able to do the assignments and everything else which we are telling you, you can probably refer to some extra material, which is this, okay, and we will give you. And for those who are preparing for JEE Advanced, I have to tell a few things, okay? First of all is that you need to, those who are preparing for JEE Advanced, you need to work at least, 100% more than everybody else, okay? That is the fact of the matter. Nobody has cracked JEE Advanced without working hard, okay? Of course, you have to be smart also, okay? So, I think Akhil might have discussed about the JEE Advanced batch. Has he discussed about it? Was JEE Advanced batch discussed? Okay, great. So we'll be forming a JEE Advanced batch. Okay, and Akhil might have already covered that for you. Okay. All right, so let me go to the... Anyone has any question, okay, you can type in. Okay, let's keep it very interactive. You can comment also. You can ask a question as well. If you have something to write or something to say, you can do that. Anyone has any comment or anything? Any doubt till now? No? See, this is again something which you should learn. Please ask a lot of doubts and be free about it. Okay. And, nobody is judging you. Nobody is here to make fun of your doubts. Okay. In fact, the silliest of doubts are probably the most important doubts. Okay. I'll tell you one of my friends. I'll keep on telling you my experiences because I was also at your age and I was also very, very shy to ask all of doubts, okay? But one of my friends, he was not shy asking a lot of doubts. He used to ask so silly doubts. Sometime he used to ask, I remember his couple of doubts as well. He was like, can the mass of electron be negative? Something like that. He was never feeling shy about it. And then after he wrote JEE, he got civil engineering, but then he was inside IIT Bombay. And later on, he did his MBA from IIM. And right now, he is in London. Okay. So I'm just telling you that how it progresses. Okay. So make sure you ask a lot of doubts. And anyway, when you ask doubts, only I can see your doubts. Okay. You are sending direct messages to me. It is not like Mockstra, which probably you have seen earlier. Okay. Here, when you type the message, only I can see the message. Okay. Is the JEE Advanced batch selective? It is based on interest or skill? Very good question. It is based on, of course, it is based on your interest. You have to be interested first. And second is, it is selective. We will select and we will recommend. We will tell you that since your performance has been improving and you are able to do the assignments in time, you are not missing any lecture, looks like you can work a little bit more harder. Okay. So we'll make you work harder. And in the JEE Advanced batch, there will be extra assignments, extra tests. All right. So yeah, the life in JEE Advanced batch is very difficult. But let me tell you, once you clear the JEE Advanced, you'll be most satisfied person. when it comes to the outcome of your hard work. Fine. So anybody else, any doubt? Okay, no doubts. Fine. So I'll just brief you about the somebody asked, if a person writes only JEE Main, what will be the benefit? What kind of institution they will get into? See, when you write JEE Main, most of the institutes other than IIT will take your marks. Okay, the NITs and all the premier institutes other than IIT will look at your JEE Main marks. And that is pretty good. We have a couple of students who have cracked JEE Advanced. They have got decent rank in JEE Main, but they choose not to go to IIT because they were not getting computer science. So rather they joined an NIT Suratkal computer science. Okay, so it is not that IIT is the, this thing, the end game. Yeah, mass, see, you're talking about antimatter and all that. Okay, so no, we are not discussing that here. I'm talking about the silliest of the doubts you can ask. Okay, so please ask the silliest of the doubts. Okay, and yes, one important thing which I wanted to tell you, which probably many of you have this myth and probably will dissuade you to work very hard, is many kids, they think that IIT is all about study. Like you work hard, get into IIT, you again work hard inside IIT, and then you keep on working harder rest of your life. So that is how the this thing is. But let me tell you that getting into IIT requires a lot of hard work. Yes, agreed. But once you are in IIT, the life is lot more fun. Okay. The biggest cultural festival happened, biggest cultural festival in Asia. You know where it happens? Inside IIT Bombay. The name is Mood Indigo. You can just search in YouTube, wherever you want to. You will see the detailing of it. Okay. Biggest cultural fest happens in IIT Bombay. Biggest technical fest happens inside IIT Bombay. There are, and the biggest sports meet, biggest college sports meet in India is Inter IIT Sports. That again happens in IIT. And there are inter hostel games. There are, there are cultural festivals every week. And there are so many things to explore other than studies, of course. So study will come probably at lesser priority than everything else. Okay. So make sure that, you are pretty well aware of it, that you, what you're aiming at. You're aiming for the best time of your life, okay? So make sure you work hard to get through it, okay? And if you get into some good college, I'm not telling that IIT is the only thing. If you get into the good college, you will, of course, be doing well in your life, okay? But then if you are not paying a lot of attention, probably then you may have to struggle next 4 years, 5 years, okay? So these times, 1 or 2 years, this is very, very crucial, okay? So I think no one has any other doubt, right? I can proceed? Okay. Right, so I think Akhil might have discussed about the bridge program, all right? So I'll just talk about the bridge program of the physics only, not the overall thing. So this is the thing which I have planned for the bridge program of physics. Okay. First of all, during the bridge program, I'm keeping it very light, okay, because I understand that it is happening while you are in class 10th. Okay. Of course, the exam is in May or June, but back of your mind, you have still to write your board exam, which you think that it is very, very important. Okay, so we'll have just 2 hours of classes per week for physics. Okay, and I think for maths and chemistry also the same. And the bridge program is a program which will enable you to accelerate when we study the class 11th, which will enable you to understand the class 11th curriculum lot more better, you know, than anybody else who has not the basic understanding of these bridge program topics. Okay, so we have topics like vectors, and I'm sure many of you have heard of these topics. So vectors, you have the basic idea about the vectors. Those who are whoever with the centum in class 10th probably might be aware of it. But how many of you know what is a vector, or have you heard of it? Okay. Right, I have a poll actually. So can you tell me, have you heard of vectors already? All of you take this poll. Have you heard of vectors already? Okay, great. Good to see that. Good. So everyone has heard of it. Okay. So now, you know, you might have heard about it and you might have the basic knowledge also about it. Okay. But then we will be getting into details of how you can use vectors or how it is useful in physics. Okay. That is what we are going to discuss, and it will take around 7 hours. So 7 hours is around three classes, let's say. Okay. Three classes, or maybe I'll try to wind up in two or two and a half classes. Okay. And then comes the constrained motion. Okay. This is, I'm not sure whether you have heard of it. Okay. So constrained motion is a topic which is related to geometry of the movement. Okay. So there'll be some constraints related to, if one object moves by, let's say, 1 centimeter, how much or with what velocity the second object will move. Okay, so I'll just give you a small this thing. Let's say if I have this scenario. Sorry. I have just drawn the basic this thing. Okay, so this is, let's say, mass m1, this is mass m2. If mass m1 moves by a distance of x1, how much this mass m2 moves? That has nothing to do with physics. That has to do with the mathematics. That has to do with constrained movement. Okay, so we'll be learning about that. There'll be many other kind of constraint. There'll be wedge constraint, pulley constraint, and in general, the constraints are there, which you should be aware of it, because many a times constrained motion is the topic which will stop you to get the answer, because everything else is so mechanized. Everything else is so straightforward. Step by step, you do this and that, but constrained motion is like solving a puzzle. So you will really enjoy the constrained motion topic whenever we do it. Okay. And then towards the end, we'll be talking about application of calculus in physics. Okay, so Akhil will be discussing about the brief introduction of the calculus. Okay, so he'll be discussing about the limits and derivatives. All those basic introduction will be there. Once he is done, we will be talking about how can we use it in physics. Okay, and this is very important, this topic, because calculus was not used till 10th. Okay. And in physics, right from the chapter number one, class 11th onwards, you will have calculus, usage of calculus. Okay. And unfortunately, students were not taught before class 11 starts. Okay. So we understand that you need to have these basic understanding of the topics before you even take up the class 11th. Okay, so more or less all of this will be covered in one and a half months, and then we'll be good to start the class 11th topics. Okay, so anyone has any comment or any question to ask, you can do so. I'll wait for a minute here. Just go through it. Let me know. Okay, great. Fine. All right, so you know, one other example of my colleague which I wanted to take, I could not, I did not remember. So I just give you that example. Okay, someone is asking doubt, so I just hold it for a minute. See, this example is one of my colleague and one of my classmate actually. So not classmate, sorry, she was working along with me in the company in which I was working. So we used to discuss how your preparation was and all that. So I came to know some astonishing facts, which I'm telling you. She was all in the rank 15, okay, 1-5. And usually we feel that, you know, we buy this material, that material, we accumulate a lot of material, and then we'll be start doing well. You know what is her source of knowledge and what all coaching and everything else she has done? First of all, she has not attended any classes, any coaching, which is actually very rare. But then I'm telling you how she has prepared. And then she was focusing only on the NCERT for physics and maths, okay? And physics more so ever. But then have you seen the physics book, class 11 books of physics? Have you seen any one of you? NCERT textbook, anyone have seen it? I think no, nobody has seen it or purchased it. Okay, so anyways, what I'll do, I'll circulate the soft copy as well of the class 11th NCERT book. So there is a set of additional exercises apart from the regular exercise. You have additional exercise in your class 11th textbook, which people ignore. So she used to solve that as well. And then she joined some test series from some coaching classes. And that is how she prepared and got all in a rank 15. So why I took that example? I took that example to tell you again that it is not about how many books you have. Okay. It's about how many problems you solve your own without looking at solution. How many doubts you discuss with your friends, with your peers, with your teachers. Okay, so I deviated a bit, but that was important. Okay, how frequently would we have to attend the assignments is the question. See, assignment is something which is given to you after every class. So we may not give you right now, probably we will be just starting, so may not have sufficient number of topics to give you assignment on. But as the thing progresses, after every class, we will be giving you assignments. We'll be circulating the books also. Centum books will be there with you. Sometimes we'll be giving assignments from those books itself. Or we will be giving you assignments as a PDF, okay, which will be given on the WhatsApp group. All right. So once the assignment is given, submission date is marked on the Class Pro. So I think all of you are aware of ClassPro. It's a class management tool. So you'll be given a login of that, okay? And you will be, against your name, when you log in, you will have an option to upload your solutions, okay? So for example, you got the assignment, I get the assignment, and then I'm solving it. Before my next physics class, I will take a picture of it. I'll create a PDF. You can upload multiple pictures also, not a problem. And then upload it on the Class Pro and submit it. That is what you have to do after, you know, before every physics class, physics assignment should be submitted. Before every maths class, maths assignment should be submitted. And it will happen every week. Okay. So I think in 9th and 10th, probably the assignments were not given that frequently, if I'm not wrong. But then 11th and 12th, there will be regular assignments every week. And you know, this is something which is the minimum you can do. The least you can do is attend the class, do the assignment. Attend the class, do the assignment. This is where your preparedness starts. This is where you are in the game. Okay. After that, if you want to get ahead, then you have to do something else. You have to struggle a little bit more, ask more doubts. You have to do something different. Okay. But then doing assignments is the first and the most important thing. Before that, you are not even in the game. Okay. Just attending the classes is merely 10 to 20% of your preparedness. Okay. Huh. There is one more question. Is the entire 11 physics, or is this only be covered in the bridge program? This is only the bridge program. These topics is only for the bridge program. Okay. So like I told you, the syllabus of physics has grown leaps and bounds. I would suggest you go through the class 11th textbook. I'll send you the soft copy of that. Okay. There are, I think 20 chapters of physics. There are 20 chapters of physics, and they are not as small as you had in class 10th. Okay. So again, I'm not scaring anyone. I'm telling you that this is what it is. And the only way to learn physics is to enjoy it and do not get into the remembering kind of mode. When you look at a problem, solve it like a puzzle. Okay, physics is going to be mathematical going forward. Just like your mathematics was, right? You don't need to remember a lot of things. You have a problem, you solve that problem by applying some basic concept, you solve it like a puzzle. Okay, now physics is also going to be something similar to that, where numericals are there, you create equations and mathematically solve it. That is how the class 11th is. I hope I have answered that. All right. So all set to start the class 11th physics now. Not exactly the curriculum, but the bridge program. Okay. Fine, guys. So let us start the class 11th curriculum. And then, you know, frankly speaking, I am not, you know, first of all, I am not aware who is, so to say, topper of the class, who has not done so well in 10th. Okay, first of all, I am not aware. And second, I don't care. Okay, this is a new beginning. Okay, class 11th onwards, those who have done well till now, you have to maintain that. And those who have not done well, you have a chance, because we are starting from what is physics. All right. Since beginning, we are talking about all three subjects, physics, chemistry, and maths. Okay. So since I'm talking about the beginning from the scratch, so can anyone tell me what is physics? We'll start from that. Okay. So what is your idea about physics? Let's keep it interactive. Okay. You can tell anything. Okay. You can say physics is mass, any random thing, whatever comes in your mind, please do not hesitate in typing it out. Nobody is seeing that. Only I am able to see your chat. Okay. So what is physics? What is your idea about the physics? Can you just type it? I wanted to see that. Okay. Okay, we have very good. I can see a lot of you have answered. Very good. And do not keep it very formal. Okay, do not keep it like, you know, like some bookish definition. I am not interested. Okay, you have to tell what you feel like. Okay, you have to tell something which layman terms. Okay, what comes in your mind when you hear physics? You can say that physics is practical maths. Okay, that is something interesting. Of course, it is a branch of science. Okay, what else? Study of how everything in nature works and everything works by abiding. Oh my God, such heavy words. Physics is a study of natural phenomena. Okay. Subject that deals with matter, space, time, and motion. Matter, space, time, and motion. What about charges? You missed that. What about heat? What about energy? Physics needs imagination to understand. Very good. It explains mysteries of the world. Very good. How things move. Okay. That is again a subset of it. So anybody else? I like physics. Oh my God. That's the best thing. Anything else? See, that's good to hear. Like, you know, I really appreciate you telling things beyond textbook. Okay, you telling things based on what you freely think. Okay, good. So keep it up. See, first of all, you need to understand the origin of physics, how physics has been, created as such. You might not be aware that, you know, when first systematic study of the nature started, as in couple of, the first human was there on the earth and couple of more, let's say, were there and thunderstorm happened for the first time in their life. And it was raining, it was dark, lightning and all that. So imagine how that guy might have felt, okay? As if God is, running behind that person. Because that guy was not aware of what is happening. Okay. So curiosity kicks in because ultimately nobody killed him, right? It was just a thunderstorm and it happened again and again in his life. So he passed on that information to his kids that listen, thunderstorm will happen. You will feel as if God is running behind you, but it is all fine. And if it is all fine, then it has to be something else other than God running behind you. So that curiosity kicks in. And then people will see in the sky and see that there are stars. Some stars are shining more than some other stars. There are, and then they realize that there are planets. There are some, star might be arranged in a particular pattern. And then they discovered something called telescope, thinking that the universe is that only. So if they understand everything which they can see, they have understood the entire nature. So they devised telescope. They started understanding the universe. Okay. And to their surprise, the more and more stronger telescope they built, the universe seems to them bigger and bigger. And that mystery never used to end. So then they got to know that there is a solar system of which they are part of. And the size of the earth is like a grain of sand with respect to the solar system. And solar system is like a grain of sand with respect to the galaxy in which we are in. And galaxy is like a grain of sand with respect to all the galaxies on the universe. And then people are talking about multiverse. So then they go crazy that it is extremely difficult to understand the universe. Okay. So the start of the physics is astronomy only. When people were trying to understand how the big objects, they behave. All right. And then they thought that, okay, fine. It looks very difficult to understand the big objects and their behavior because it is never ending. All right. So they thought that why not understand the smallest object? Because ultimately everything else is built from that small object. So they started breaking it that I will see the smallest particle, how it behaves. Everything else will be the collective behavior of all the things. Okay. So when they break the substance, they reached molecular level, atomic level, Then they reach the inside the atom. There are proton, neutron, electron. And then later on, you know, nowadays people are talking about breaking them as well. And then something crazy hits them, which is quantum physics. And quantum physics tells you that if you observe some phenomena, if you observe that phenomena, phenomena will change. You're not allowed to observe. And that is crazy. According to quantum physics, you can be at two places at the same time. You are attending class here, as well as you are in Marathali roaming around and without mask. That is all happening. But then if you go and observe, if you try to observe, that event will be gone. Okay, so it was crazy at that level, at the bigger level, and it is crazy at the smallest level as well. Okay, so we are stuck with understanding things in a very limited manner. We cannot understand everything about the universe. We cannot understand everything about the tiniest of the particle. But we can understand quite a bit about some common day-to-day life activities and the masses around us. So, physics, first of all, is not a very structured science. Okay, for big, huge objects like stars, suns, you have theory of relativity and the other things to deal with. Same theory you cannot apply to a very, very small particle like electron. So there are different set of rules for electrons, different set of rules for big objects, different set of rules for an object which is moving extremely fast. Okay, so it is extremely diverse and unstructured, so to say, physics. But the best part is, in class 11th, we will be focusing on a portion of the physics which appears to be very structured, and your life is at peace here, at least that, you know, you'll feel as if everything is structured. So we'll stuck with Newtonian physics, okay, which is very, very structured. Yeah, many different theories sometimes contradict themselves. Yeah, of course, there are wave nature theory, wave particle duality is a contradictory theory, but still they exist. But then you need to understand that when a certain object behave like wave, when a certain object behave like a particle, you know, it is like, you know, just to give you a very interesting, this thing example, suppose, look at yourself. Don't you think that depending on your mood, you behave differently at times compared to, let's say, when you're angry, you behave differently. When you're happy, you behave differently. When you're talking to your parents, you behave differently. When you're talking to your friends, your behavior is completely different, right? So why not particles, right? So that is why different theories are there. The way they are behaving changes depending on the scenario itself. So first you need to understand the scenario, okay? Then apply the theory, okay? But then again, coming back to class 11 physics, I'll not deviate too much. Now, first of all, physics, like some of you have rightly said, is, you know, we are trying to understand how nature works, okay? How, let's put it very bluntly, we are trying to understand how God runs the universe, as simple as that, okay? We are trying to understand that. That is physics, okay? But then somebody will say that, it's like a philosophy. Philosophy is like, you know, somebody is giving you gyan that you have, God wants everybody to be happy. God wants you to do the good deeds. God wants everybody to be friends. So that is also, you know, what God wants you to do. But is that physics? Somebody tells you that, my head is feeling heavy. Okay, so you will probably, if you're a philosopher, you'll be like, oh, probably you have not slept. or probably you are very sad, something like that you will say. But then a physicist will say that is nonsense. Your mass of the head remains same. Okay, so there is a big, big difference between philosophy and physics. In fact, physics, although have originated from philosophy only, because physics has taken PHY from the philosophy and ICS from the mathematics. So it has become physics. Okay. So when you take the philosophy of how the show is running in the universe and try to quantify it, okay, you need to understand that when you try to quantify something, so coming back to the same example, when somebody comes and tells you that I am feeling heavy in my head, so as a physicist who is very, very novice, they should ask exactly how much heavy you are feeling, how many grams, right? So if you can't quantify it, then it is not physics. Understand? So we are dealing with quantifying everything we observe, everything in nature, whatever we observe, we are trying to put some number. Okay. Talking about mass, we have number to associate with it. So let's say 5 kg, 10 kg, 100 kgs. Okay. Talking about heat, we have temperature, let's say. Talking about speed, measures in meters per second. Talking about luminous intensity, candela. Okay. There will be various other such things which are there in physics, which will try to quantify each and everything you observe. If you can't quantify it, it is not physics. Clear? So now, first thing we will do here is we are going to talk about what all the, these quantities which I am discussing with you, which are used to quantify whatever you are observed, they are called physical variables. Okay. So I want to hear from you, what are the physical variables you are aware of? Okay. So I'll just put a heading here. So these physical variables are used to quantify things. Okay. Can you type in what are the physical variables you are aware of? And these things are very obvious. I'll write down few things my own. For example, mass is something which I observe and we can measure also. Mass, time, length, what else? Okay, great. So we have quite a few now. Density. Now feel free. Anything you measure is a physical variable, period. Anything. So people are telling charge, correct. You have energy, very good. Temperature. You have current. What else? Velocity. Okay, volume. Some of you might say that, sir, volume and area, they are mathematical quantities. Okay, mathematics is evolved when physics found it difficult to observe things. Okay, mathematics helps you to analyze the scenario without observing it directly. How do you think, relativity, theory of relativity have evolved? Mathematics is like, you can say, eyes to the blind man. Okay, they will create an equation, help you analyze things. So mathematics is there to help physics, that's all. Okay, anyways, volume, area, correct. Then mass, length, time, density. Density I have not written, I'll write it. Density, see, I want the list to be as exhaustive as possible. So if you think that something is missing, immediately tell me. density, then speed, and you can be wrong. Okay, don't worry about being right or wrong. Acceleration. Okay, luminous intensity. Frequency, very good. Resistance. Resistance and amount, as in number of substances. Volume is written. Amplitude is length. Don't you think so? Amplitude is a length, which I have written here. Gravity is a force, which I have written. Force I have written? No. So I'll write force. Then, am I missing anything? Volume is there. Okay. There are so many other things. So many other things, which you probably have never heard of, maybe, but some of you should have. Is that it? Good, Surya. Torque. What else? Think about something which is not listed here, but you measure it. Momentum. Tension is a force. Don't you think so? Tension is a force, which is listed here. Temperature I have written. This is temperature. Something which you measure. A very, very simple thing, which is not listed here, but you measure it. What is that? Distance is length. Don't you think so? Okay, but I'll write it. Distance. Somebody is saying that. Distance. Okay, magnetic field. Good. Magnetic field. Then correct. Electric field. Weight is again a force. One thing which you have been measuring since your standard 2 or 3, which you're not remembering. Sound is a wave. So you don't measure sound, do you? You can say the intensity of the sound. Okay. But sound as such, not. So I'll write intensity. Electric potential. Okay. Power, all kinds of power. Probability. Probability, you can say covered in the amount of substance and all that. Resistivity. Okay, very good. Very good. Resistivity is one. What else? Many things are there which you have seen, but you are not able to recollect. Gravity is a force, which I have anyway mentioned. Okay. All right. So what about angle? Angle is also a physics variable. Okay. Angle. Have you heard of angular velocity? Have you heard of it? So angular velocity. Have you heard of angular momentum? Angular momentum. Then, have you heard of angular acceleration? If you have not heard of it, it is perfectly fine. It does not matter. Okay, we will discuss it later on when the time comes. tangential acceleration. Correct. Tangential acceleration is a normal acceleration, okay, which we have discussed, which we have written here. Okay, why? But they are just adding up different translational velocities. No. See, rate of change of angle is angular velocity. Understand that. It is a different thing altogether. Rate at which angle changes is angular velocity. We'll be discussing it. Just that I'm telling you upfront. Rate of coverage of the displacement is your velocity. So angular velocity and velocity, they are two different things. Okay. Fine. So is that it? Anything else you want to write here? You know, the list could go on and on. Spin. Spin is also there. Then, you know, there are so many quantum physics variables. The list goes on. So physics is about knowing all these variables. Okay. If you have theoretical knowledge about physics and you're not able to quantify or measure anything, all that knowledge is not useful. Okay. Now, when you look at these physical variables, which you have to measure, one thing which will be very, very important is this, that of course you'll be using numbers to measure, right? Somebody asks you what is mass, you have to tell some real number. You have to tell 5 kg or 5.5 or 7.6 kgs, right? So you have to use a real number to tell these quantities. Fine. Apart from these type of quantities, there are a set of quantities in which only telling, what about the dark matter quantification in that? No, we are not getting into all that, okay? Dark matter, antimatter, black hole, time travel, time dilation, you know, we can discuss it one-on-one, okay? But not while we are discussing in a class, okay? Anyways, so coming back to the class 11th curriculum, what I was telling was that the quantities in front of you, one set of quantities you can understand by just having a number associated with it. Okay. But then there will be some other kind of quantities in which just telling a number is not sufficient. If I just tell you a number, that number will not give you complete information. Suppose you ask me, what is the force? What amount of force? And if I tell you force is 10 newtons, 10 newtons is a force, that information is not sufficient for me to tell whether this pen will move or not. If I put this pen like this, and if I put 10 Newton force vertically down, will this pen move? No, pen will stay there only. If I push it like this, pen will start moving, but in that direction. If I push it like that, pen will start moving this direction. Okay. So the point is, there'll be one set of physical variables which will require only number to tell so that you understand complete information. If you ask me what is mass, if I tell you 10 kgs, you are not going to ask me back in which direction the 10 kg. Okay, that is useless, pointless to ask. But a lot of quantities, they require you not only to tell the number, magnitude, but also to tell in which direction they are. Okay, so these are called vector quantities. Okay, so vector quantity, it is not a mathematics concept. It is a physics concept. Okay. They require you to tell which direction it is. Okay. One simple example could be that if I tell you that, listen, there is a treasure 1 kilometer from where you are sitting. Okay. Go and find it. That information is practically useless. I have to tell you which direction it is, right? So anyways, so I want you to tell me the quantities which are written in front of you. Can you name those quantities in which you not only need real number to tell, you have to also tell the direction. Can you tell me in front of you what are they? Just name it. Okay, velocity. Where is velocity? Okay, acceleration is one. Then velocity, angular velocity. Okay, then momentum. Then angular momentum. Okay, force. Okay, somebody is saying time. I'll come back to it. Torque as well. Okay. Why torque? Okay, torque, some of you might not be completely aware. Torque requires a direction sense. Okay, current. Do you need direction? Do you need send? Do you need to know the direction of the current? And the answer is yes. Okay, but it is not a vector quantity. And why it is not a vector quantity, we are going to discuss later on. Although it requires a sense of direction, but it does not follow rules, vector rules. Okay, so we'll discuss in detail later on. Magnetic and electric field. Magnetic field, electric field. What else? Is angle, does angle require a sense of direction? If I tell you 30 degrees angle, will you ask which direction? The answer is yes, you will ask. I'll give you an example here. You have these two pens, okay? This is the baseline. The angle with this pen is 30 degree. So won't you ask angle like this is 30 or like that is 30? Like this or like that? It is clockwise 30 degrees or anti-clockwise 30 degrees. Does it make sense? Okay. So even angle, my dear friends, you may not be knowing it, but angle requires a sense of direction. Okay. Ajay, tell me, what about area? Does area require a sense of direction? All of you. Area requires sense of direction or not? And the answer is yes, it requires sense of direction. Okay. So let me tell you. Okay, so let me tell you one example. Suppose I tell you that, what example I take? Let's say this is the example. If I tell you that area of this is 6 meter square, 6 meter square is the area. Okay. So the natural question you should ask back, is the area of the front surface is 6 or the back surface is 6? Don't you think so? Front and back area could be different. Area could be different. The back could be little bit more protruded like that. Okay. So area could be different on the back side. Fine. So area also require a sense of direction, and yes, area is a vector quantity. You're going to learn more about that when we discuss magnetic field and electric field. Okay. So I know it was never discussed till class 10th. Okay. Because it was not required. Okay. What else? What about angular acceleration? Is that a vector quantity? Does it require a sense of direction? Yes, it requires. Every acceleration requires a sense of direction. Okay. Now, That's it. Okay. So you can see here why I'm highlighting all these things is to let you know that, my dear friends, you are in physics, you are dealing with two kind of quantities. Physics is about quantification, letting know how much is the quantity or what is the number and all that. And you have two types of quantities. And it is not that vector quantities are lesser in number or scalar quantities are more in number. In fact, displacement is also a vector. Did I not mention it here? Displacement is not written. Displacement is not written. But then yes, displacement is a vector quantity. A vector quantity is a quantity which requires both a number to tell what is it and the direction as well. Okay. So in physics, you will see that the quantities which require a sense of direction, they are more in number. Okay. Here itself, you can count. I have randomly written whatever quantities come in mind. Probably you can see here that the box quantities, they are more in number. Okay. So that is the reason why we need to understand how every kind of quantity behave, right? We have understood since our childhood, like my daughter is in grade one right now. She has already started learning how scalars work. What is a scalar? It's just a number. Okay. So she is learning about how you multiply it, how you add it, how you subtract it, how you divide it. Okay. All those things you are learning right from your childhood. Okay. So I don't need to tell you that how scalars will behave, how to add them, how to multiply them, how to subtract them or divide it. I don't need to tell you that. But when it comes to vector, till now, you know, most of the students will never discuss or will never get a chance to understand in detail about the vectors. But physics is more about vectors. So that's the reason why we are getting into details of the vectors. Okay. We just know, okay, fine, vector requires direction as well as the magnitude. But do we know how vectors are added? Do you know how vectors are multiplied? Can I divide vectors with another vector? Okay. All these things we should be aware of. Otherwise, how will I, you know, deal with forces? Suppose multiple forces are acting on a simple object. You have to add them to tell that total amount of force is this. Now you cannot add them like numbers. Okay, just a simple example. If one force from this direction is 1 newton, other force from that direction is also 1 newton. The total force on this pen is 0, right? Because 1 newton from here, 1 newton from there, it is 0. But if you treat it like a number, 1 plus 1 should be 2. Okay, so, but they are in different directions. So that is why you subtracted it. So we are going to learn now about the vectors and how they behave. Okay. We did some adding and subtracting vectors when learning about the force. Yeah, of course you did it. But then let me tell you, you're going to learn a lot of other things. Okay, so let us proceed. See, like I told you, I'm not assuming that anybody knows anything before coming to the class itself. Otherwise, what will happen is that some of the students might not be aware of a few things. They will feel left behind. Some of the students might be aware of something. So just bear with me. I'm sure in just one or two classes, you will be seeing something completely new. Okay. But then I want to start from scratch. Okay. Do you want me to increase the speed of the class, or is the speed fine? Do you want me to decrease the speed? You can tell that. Is the pace of the class fine? Okay, pace is fine, but yeah, increase the speed. Some of you are trying to we can go a little faster. Okay. All right, so we don't worry. Physics is changed completely now. You are in class 11th, and let me tell you, it is going to be a lot more fun. And you know, the physics will be fun when you spend time in understanding the basics. Okay, the complicated thing doesn't require your time to understand. If you focus on your basic, complicated theory and complicated numericals, you'll automatically be able to solve it. Okay. Anyways, so let me start with vectors, which some of you might be aware of. So vectors is, you know, it's a quantity. All right, just like scalars, it is a quantity which follow different set of rules. Okay, it's not like numbers. So just like when we were kid, we were trying to understand how numbers are added, how numbers are multiplied, subtracted, and all that. We are going to do the exact same way, understanding how vectors behave, but then we'll be doing it quickly. Okay. So vectors, first of all, can be dealt with geometrically as well as algebraically. Draw this. There's a geometrical interpretation of it, and there is algebraic interpretation of it. Okay, you'll understand by using algebra. Right now, my focus is geometrical. Okay, so there are different ways geometrically how you represent a vector and algebraically how you represent a vector. There are two different ways. Okay, has any one of you have seen something like this? A1 I cap plus A2 J cap plus A3 K cap. Has any one of you have seen like that? Okay, some of you have seen it. Good. So that is the algebraic notation of it. Okay. Right now, our focus is geometrical. Now, let us understand how geometrically we can, represent a vector. First of all, we need to show the magnitude as well as direction, because vector quantity has a direction. And what is the best way you can represent a direction? What comes into mind when you have to tell the direction? You'll point out that is a direction, right? You'll point out like that, okay? And if you have to draw the direction, what do you do? You draw an arrow. Don't you think so? That's the most obvious thing. You draw an arrow like that, okay? Now, if somebody comes and tells me that, no, I am more comfortable drawing the direction like that, like this. And this tip is the direction. Is there anything wrong with this? Is this wrong? Everyone? There is nothing wrong. Okay, there is nothing wrong with it, all right? But it is uncomfortable, all right? You will see that this is very comfortable way you can represent. So why to complicate unnecessarily? That's a simple and straightforward thing, okay? Now, the length tells you what is the magnitude. Okay. And the arrow head tells you the direction. Okay. Now, if I take this arrow, it'll be difficult to understand once there are more quantities. Yes. That's what, if you have, let's say, multiple multiple arrows are there, and multiple cones, if you draw like that, it'll be very difficult. Okay, so this is clear, right? Now, if I take an arrow, take this arrow and move it in a place, let's say I take exactly this only and I draw it here. Okay, I've drawn it here. Taken this as it is, replaced there. Has length changed? No. Has the direction changed? Direction changed for this arrow or not? Is the direction or the length changed? No. Direction is still pointing that way and the length is also the same. So we can geometrically, we can move a vector parallel to itself. Parallel to itself without affecting anything. That is first thing, okay? And if I reverse this, if I reverse the vector like that, direction is reversed. Direction is completely reversed, but the length is exactly the same. Suppose I tell that this vector is A, just like, you know, if I tell A is a number, okay, I can say this is a vector, but then, you know, you should not get confused whether it is a number or a vector. So I put a bar on top of it. So a variable with a bar represents a vector. Understand? All right. Now, if you move it here, it remains A only because neither the direction nor the magnitude is changed. But if I reverse it, direction is completely reversed, 180 degree. Then what happens is, okay, then what happens is I will use sign to tell that direction. Okay, negative sign means that it is opposite of what it was earlier in terms of direction. The length remains same. Okay, so if this is A, this will be minus A. So these are something which are very, you can say, in basic things, but it is important for you to know that if this is A, if you know it, it becomes minus A and you can move it around like that. All right, so this is the representation, geometrical representation. Okay, now let's see how to add two vectors. Okay, write down addition. With Ajay, can you tell me, can I add vector with a scalar? Does it make sense? Can I add vector with a scalar? I cannot add vector with a scalar. So when I say addition with vectors, it automatically means vector addition with another vector only. All right. In fact, I'll tell you something which some of you might be aware anyways. You look at these quantities, all these quantities, you cannot add one quantity here with any other quantity. You cannot add mass with time. You cannot add length with density, cannot add density with speed, luminous intensity with frequency, everything has its own universe. Mass will be added and subtracted from the mass only. Density from the density only. Speed from the speed only. Okay. So not only you can not add a scalar with the vector, you cannot add a physical quantity with another physical quantity. Okay. All right, so coming back to the addition with the vectors, let's see how it gets added up. And it should be a logical sequence. It should be logical. Okay, I have a doubt. What if we move the arrow upward 90 degree? Will the sign be negative? See, it will become a different vector. It will, you cannot represent it with only A. Understood? If you reverse it, you can represent it by using letter A only. But if you are rotating it by 90 degree like that, you cannot represent it by using A. It becomes a different vector. Understood? Okay, so let's see what is logical way of adding two vectors. Let's say I have a vector like this. Okay. This is one vector. And I have, let's say, another vector like that. Geometrically, I should add up. Now, what is the logical way of adding these two? When I add these two vector, a third vector will come in. Where it is? How to draw that? This is vector A, and let's say this is vector B. Can you draw it? All of you try drawing it. Okay, connecting tip of A with the tip of B. Okay, fine. That is all right. So you can, you know, many of you are telling this. Many of you are telling that this is A plus B, which is correct. It's correct. Nothing wrong. My question to you, what is the logic? Why? Why this should be A plus B? The answer is correct. But why? Anyone? You can take an example of a vector quantity and explain it. No one? Okay, see. If let's say a mass goes from this point number one to point number two, the displacement is A. Okay. Then it goes from two to three. Okay. So when it goes from, let's say, one to two, one displacement, then two to three, another displacement, right? So it started from here, it reached there. So when I add the two displacement, it should give me net displacement. And net displacement should be 1, 2, 3. Make sense? All of you? Two balls move at different direction, collide, move direction different from initial direction. Okay, pushing a trolley obliquely. Yes, in a way that is also fine, but I have taken the most simple this thing. Okay, so I hope this is clear. Now tell me, when you add the two numbers, let's say if I have to add 3 and 2, 3 plus 2 is equal to 5. Okay, but here the length, when you add 1, 2, 3, the length of 1 to 3 is not equal to length 1 to 2 plus length 2 to 3. Right? They're not equal. So when you add two vectors, it might result in a lesser quantity compared to if it was a scalar quantity. So that you need to understand. Okay. And the magnitude of a vector, magnitude of A is represented like this. This is magnitude of A. This is represented as length of side. Okay, so triangle inequality, you are all aware of. So if I add two vectors, it becomes a third side, which is of course less than the sum of the two sides. This is triangle inequality. Okay. So although it is fine, we have to exactly find out what is the length of it. Okay. This is called triangle law of addition. Triangle law of addition. We'll soon find out what is the exact length of this. But before we do that, let me again go back to the point of current. I told you that current, even though it has direction, it does not follow vector law of addition. That is why it is not a vector. Okay. So if one current comes like this, another current comes like this. Okay, let's say 2 ampere comes here and 2 ampere comes there. Ideally, if it is a vector, it should become zero. It doesn't become zero. 4 ampere will come from that side, like that. Okay, so it has a direction, but it is not a vector. Fine. All right, so let's quickly find out the magnitude or the length of the third side. Okay. Sorry about it. Let's take some examples and then we'll rush towards finding out the quantity. So what I want you to do first is to add these two vectors. Draw it on your notebook, A and B, and can you show where is A plus B? Okay, show me where is A plus B. Let me know once you're done, basically. So what you should do first? What is the first thing you should do? If you have to apply triangle law of addition to add these two vectors, what is the first thing you should do? All of you. Look at how we have added. Look at how we have added two vectors. Look at it. The two vectors which we are adding, should connect head to tail. This is the tail of B and this is the head of A. Head of A should touch the tail of B. Okay. So, correct. So looks like some of you have already already done something like that. So what I'll do, I'll move B. When I move B like that, which I can do because a vector will not change its magnitude or direction when I move it parallel to itself. So it remains B only. Okay, it remains B only. And A plus B then will be that. This is A plus B. Okay. And let me write down first. This is A plus B. And if you join these two points, what you will get? It has become parallelogram. Right? And this vector, if you show this as an arrow, this is also a vector parallel to itself, same length, is the same vector. Okay, so this is parallelogram. So some of the textbook, they will refer parallelogram law of vectors, parallelogram law of addition, which is nothing but a modification of the triangle law of addition only. Okay, let's take another question, then we'll proceed. Let's say this is A, okay? And let's say Okay, same kind of scenario. This is B. I want to find out what is A minus B. Geometrically, how to find out A minus B? Can you do that? Let me know once you're done. Okay, done. Now, you have learned how to add two vectors. And now I am asking you how to subtract two vectors. What you can do here is you can change it to A plus minus B. So basically, A minus B is same as adding minus B to A. Okay. So if this is B, minus B is what? What is minus B? Minus B is this. The opposite direction is minus B. That way. Okay. And the best thing that they are connected head to tail. All right. And then this is your A minus B. This is your A minus B. Okay. Understood? All of you, can you tell me where is B minus A? Where is B minus A? B minus A is zero. No. Where is B minus A? If this is A minus B, don't you think that B minus A is equal to negative of A minus B? Don't you think so? So, negative of this vector, which is A minus B, is B minus A. So B minus A is this. Opposite of it. That's it. Clear? Okay. So, I'll quickly summarize few things here is, is that if you draw a parallelogram like this, it's a parallelogram, let's say, this is vector A, this is vector B, then this is also B. So this is A plus B. This is what we have discussed. Okay, this is A plus B. A plus B. Where is B plus A? Where is B plus A? If this is A plus B, where is B plus A? Correct. So B plus A is same as A plus B. Okay. A plus B. Okay. Now here, where is A minus B? For A minus B, I will take reverse of B. It becomes minus B. And then this is A minus B. Okay. So one diagonal is sum of two vectors. Other one represent the difference of two vectors. Difference of two vectors. So drawing parallelogram actually helps sometimes, because you not only get the sum of the two vectors, you get a difference of two vectors on the same parallelogram. Okay. So the next thing I wanted to discuss is the angle between the two vectors. How to find out that? Angle between two vectors. First of all, to tell the angle, you need two lines, right? I cannot just give you one line like this. If I tell you that, tell me the angle this line has. You don't have any answer, because you need at least two lines, right? The two lines, what angle it makes. So that's what here, you need two vectors. So how to determine the angle between two vectors? Because the main problem you're going to face, suppose two lines are like that. Okay, so angle between the two line is this one or that one? It is one or two, which one? That is a problem which you'll face in vectors. So let me draw a diagram here, and I'm going to ask you logically, what do you think it should be? Let's say, this is vector A and this is vector B, fine. And let's say I extend the line of A little bit like that. So the angle is theta, or the angle is phi. Between two vectors A and B, what is the angle? Theta or phi? And there should be some logic, okay? Don't guess. Like, even if you guess it, please tell what do you why do you think it is? Okay, some of you saying theta, some of you saying phi. Why? Give the reason also, please. And reason can be random, okay? I don't care, you know, that a very sophisticated reason should be there. You can say, I have seen something like that and I feel it is like that. It's one of fine. Cause we are following, okay. Mm-hmm. Others, don't sit quiet. Okay, where two vectors meet, what if I have the same scenario like that? I'm displacing a vector like this. This becomes A. Is this any different? Don't you think it is same only? Wherein this is theta and this is phi. Don't you think it is same? I have displaced A parallel to itself. Reason, what is the reason? Okay, answer may be correct or wrong. Very good. That's a good reason. That's a niche, right? Good. Others, when somebody tells you angle, what comes in your mind? The first thing that should strike in your head is sense of rotation. Okay, so suppose B has to align in the direction of A. Okay, listen carefully. If B has to align, see, I'm not talking about rules here. Okay, I'm talking about why that rule is there. Okay, why common vertex should be there, why it has to be like that. That is what I'm discussing here. Okay. So can you tell me how much B should be rotated so that direction of B should become same as direction of A? Is it theta or phi? It's theta, right? It's theta, that's obvious. How much A have to be rotated so that it comes in the direction of B? That is also theta, right? So that is why theta is the angle. Understood, all of you? So that is why theta is the angle between the two vectors. And then comes the rule. Okay, the rule is when you have to find the angle between the two vectors, what you do? Connect two vectors tail to tail. Okay, tail to tail you connect and then measure the angle. Don't connect like this. This is not correct. Okay. So when you add it, you have to connect head to tail. But when you have to find out the angle, you have to connect tail to tail. All right. So I think the basic introduction of vector, all of you are aware. What is A? What is minus A? What is the angle between the two vectors? How you add it geometrically? These are the ABCD of the vectors. Okay. I think we have limited time, but then what I'll do is that I'll just start something and we'll continue it to the next class. Okay, that's good to know. All right, so now what I had started here, some of the two vectors we are trying to find out. Let's say this is one vector, vector A. You have another vector. This is vector B. This is the angle between the two vectors. Let's say angle is theta. Okay. So geometrically, it is very easy. You know, what I'll do is that I will draw another line like this. And then I will create a parallelogram like that. And we will be able to find out the sum of the two vectors geometrically. But then let me tell you, it is extremely difficult to accurately find out what is the sum of the two vectors geometrically. Then you have to be very, very accurate in terms of drawing your angles, drawing the length of the vectors. Sometime vector could be 10 kilometers. Will you draw 10 kilometer line? Right? So geometrically, you know, it is good to know, but ultimately you have to use algebra only. Okay. So I'll just draw here A plus B, and then we'll try to find out the algebraic formula of the length of A plus B. Okay. So I'll just give you a little bit of hint and expect you to lead it forward. Has anyone already done something like this? Have you found out the length of A plus B already? Earlier? No? Okay, some of you did. Okay, good. If you've done it, good. So now if I do this construction, can you tell me how this construction helps you? I have done this construction here. You can see that. Okay. What is the biggest help from this construction? Everyone. The biggest help is, good. So biggest help is I have got two right angle triangle. See, throughout the physics, I'm going to discuss about what you should think rather than what you should write. Okay, why it is coming, how it is coming. Okay, so that is why I'm asking you, why there is a construction like this. How does that help you? You get two right angle triangles. So you can use Pythagoras theorem twice, which you already know. Okay. So how you find out something which you do not know? Something you do not know, you find it by using what you know. Okay, what do you know? Pythagoras theorem. You have to use it. I can use Pythagoras theorem twice. Okay, so let us try to, okay, since time is running out, I just want you to let's say, just write down the equations. That's it. Let's say this angle, although it is not given, you can use this angle in terms of that. You can just write down Pythagoras theorem for two right angle triangle. 1, 2, 3, 4. You have triangle 1, 2, 3 and triangle 2, 4, 3. Two right angle triangles are there. Can you write down the Pythagoras theorem for both the right angle triangle? And then we are done for the class. Let me know once you have written down. Sorry. This will be theta only. I thought it was phi there. Okay. Okay, done. Okay. Navtej, is that your name? Am I pronouncing your name correct? Navtej? Okay. Navtej is done. Others? Three to four length is this. Okay. 1 to 4 length is this. Can you tell me 4 to 2 length is what? What is 4 to 2 length? This length is how much? Do you all agree it will be B cos theta? This hypotenuse, okay? You guys know the basic trigonometry, right? Cos theta is base divided by hypotenuse. You guys are aware of this, right? Because sometimes students are not, so I'm asking. You're aware of this, okay? So base is hypotenuse times cos theta. That's what it is written. This is what? What is this? B sine theta. Right? Sine theta is perpendicular divided by hypotenuse. All right. So perpendicular is hypotenuse times sine theta. So 4 to 2 is B cos theta. And 3 to 2 is B sine theta. Now life is chill. Okay. You can see here that in a triangle 1, 2, 3, you can say A plus B whole square. This is hypotenuse. The length of the hypotenuse, you have to take mod. That tells you the length. Okay. You can't just say A plus B like that. A plus B is a vector. I'm talking about length. So that's why these two bars. This is equal to 1 to 2 length is length of 1 to 4 plus length of 4 to 2, which is B cos theta. That square plus B sine theta whole square. Okay. So for triangle 2, 3, 4, writing Pythagoras theorem won't help because you get B is equal to B for that. So this is it. All right. So what I'll do, I'll just leave you with quick things which you can, after the class, just you can message in the group. What I want is you derive expression for A plus B. What you have to do, just simplify this and get the expression for A plus B and tell me maximum value of A plus B and minimum of A plus B. Okay, how much it is? You can change angle theta. The angle can change. At what angle maximum happens and what is it? At what angle minimum happens and what is it? So I want you to message it on the group. Just want to see who will message on the group, and that's it. Okay, so we'll meet next week. All right, continue from here. And so probably next week we'll be solving more number of questions, and so next week also vectors. All right, so great interacting with you guys. Look forward to teach you as well for entire year, and I'm sure you will generate great result. I have heard a lot about you guys from Tushar and the other teachers. I think Ankur as well took your classes, right? So let's see how it goes, right? So bye for now. Take care.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, you answer in WhatsApp group.